This is the feed for Tuesday, the 15th of September 2015, and yes, the 29th Prime Minister of Australia is Malcolm Turnbull. He has been sworn in. As somebody joked on Twitter today, Australia has now had more frontmen than INXS. My name is Mark Fennell, and this is a very special episode of the feed. We are joined at the desk by a former Liberal advisor and the host of Radio National's excellent show, Between the Lines, Tom Switzer, welcome. Mark. And Fairfax columnist and the author of the excellently titled book, The Inexplicably Long and Embarrassing Reign of Captain Abbott, Andrew P. Street. Are you going to like have to rename that now?
I believe we're going back to the original title.
Which was?
Short and excruciatingly embarrassing. So,
right.
You know, we're swapping out some adjectives.
The hashtag for the show is The Feed. Will you vote for Prime Minister Turnbull? I was about to say Abbott. Oh my God. At the next election, let us know on Twitter. The hashtag is The Feed. SBS.
Living in the past.
I know. The poll out today already has him as the preferred Prime Minister at 70%, Shorten at 24%. But how will you vote? Let us know. While you're doing that, let's catch up with just what the hell happened today.
I think there are tears shed.
From you?
I'm not enjoying this, Carl. It's a very difficult time.
Yeah, not for Malcolm it wasn't. He's had a cracker of a day. Bloody got made Prime Minister, bought his own pen and everything. The ever-dull opposition leader also took the news pretty well too.
One down, one to go.
We can only assume he's referring to when Tanya Plibersek does the same thing to him in about 15 to 20 minutes. He said some other stuff too, but it's Bill Shorten and no one cares. Oh, well, we have to play it? Fine then.
Malcolm Turnbull has sold out all of the things which he always said were very important to him.
Thank you, wet sponge pretending to be opposition leader Bill Shorten. Oh, and there was this from professional crazy man and Liberal backbencher Cory Bernardi.
It's just treachery of the highest order.
He said, channeling the spirit of a flabbergasted American Civil War captain. Very relevant, Cory. Then, of course, there was the figurative Pagliacci of this entire affair, the former Prime Minister himself, Tony Abbott.
Welcome to Dumpville. Population, you.
Yeah, it's too soon. And even though his speech barely acknowledged that he may have done anything to put himself in this situation and instead blamed the media and other politicians, you did end up feeling sorry for the guy.
I've never leaked or backgrounded against anyone, and I certainly won't start now.
No, Tony, but you did benefit immensely from the backgrounding and leaking when the Labor Party were doing it. So, to sum up, Malcolm Turnbull is your new Prime Minister, Tony Abbott is not, and the Labor Party would be better off if they replaced Bill Shorten with a medium-sized ficus tree. Back to Mark in the studio.
Thanks, voiceover Mark. Now, Tom Switzer, you got name-checked in question time today by Tanya Plibersek. She pulled out a 2012, I think, thing you wrote about Malcolm Turnbull where you called him, and I love this, ignorant, arrogant, and Tony Abbott light. Has your opinion changed on the Prime Minister?
Well, I think I was writing about Malcolm Turnbull when he was the opposition leader in 2009, and he's entitled to think that he's changed, and some might say now that I'm at the ABC that I've changed.
Yeah, you dirty pinko, you. In terms of what, like, Turnbull didn't just win because people like him. He had to give things away. There are concessions that he made. What sort of concessions has he had to make?
I think two main concessions. One's on climate change. You may recall in 2009 when he lost the leadership, it was primarily over the emissions trading scheme. You have to remember the broad cross-section of the party, the grassroots of the membership, are opposed to either a carbon tax or an emissions trading scheme. And I think that he recognises that there's no point in reviving that issue, certainly not before the next election.
Now, see, that's problematic because there's a whole swathe of Australians, kind of central, maybe a little bit lefty Australians that really like Malcolm Turnbull, and they like him because they perceive him to be different, Andrew P. Street. When they realise that things aren't going to change, how long do you reckon that that honeymoon period is just going to collapse?
I think one of the big problems with the people who like Malcolm Turnbull because he's sort of perceived as being
leather
a bit lefty.
Jacket. It's all about the leather
jacket. It's complete, and the idea that he's really angling for the co-host gig on Q&A. I think, like, most of those people aren't people who are probably going to vote for the coalition. So I think at some point he's going to have to make a choice, which is do I appeal to that constituency who are not going to vote for me, or do I fall more in line with the mainstream of the party? And I think this is going to be a difficult one for him to finesse because he is, you know, he has been so vocal about this. This has been one of his points of difference with Tony Abbott.
All right, a lot of people criticise Tony Abbott for not having enough women in cabinet, and you would assume that in any cabinet reshuffle they would introduce more women into cabinet. Is that your take on it, Tom Switzer?
Yes, although not someone like Rowan Bishop.
Probably not. No, I suspect you'd probably be right
but
on
there's
that.
Already... You don't think her renaissance is just around the corner?
No, although she was very
Transport
cool towards
Minister,
Tony
Abbott.
Minister for helicopters. Look, there's already...
We've got one for submarines. I mean, come on.
There's two female cabinet ministers already, Susan Lee in health and obviously Julie Bishop, the deputy prime minister. I suspect that Malcolm Turnbull will bring into the fold some women. Kelly O'Dwyer, member for Higgins. This is Peter Costello's old seat and young understudy. I think she's deserving of a senior post. And there'll probably be some other women like Maurice Payne, the senator, who'll be elevated. But there won't be too many changes, I don't think. I mean, the main changes, I think, will be around the economics portfolio and defence.
So we're talking about Scott Morrison.
Yeah.
The consensus is he's going to become the treasurer.
I think so. And fair enough, too. I mean, let's be frank. Whatever you think of Morrison, he has been a very capable minister in both the immigration and social services portfolios. And I think
he's a bad enemy to have within the party,
that's
too.
That's right. So yeah. I mean, he's the kind of guy who presses the left's buttons, just like Malcolm Fraser did in the 1970s, John Howard and Tony Abbott, and they all became Prime Minister. So he's a man on the rise, and I think he'll be the Treasury spokesperson,
Andrew,
which means that Joe Hockey will be
as
shafted.
As a representative of the left, you feel like Scott Morrison presses your buttons?
It's eerie how much he presses my buttons.
All right, now
it's
when
disturbing. I sleep very badly.
Even more than Tony Abbott did.
No one inspired a book like Tony Abbott did.
Right.
Now, when Julia Gillard rolled Kevin Rudd, she got a very, very negative reaction both in the press and the electorate. Is that going to be different this time? Are people more used to it, or is there more going on here?
Look, I think that's a very good question. I think that this is the new norm in Australian politics. It's a real problem for the body politic. I mean, ever since the demise of John Howard in 2007, we've had these musical chairs in Canberra. We've had five prime ministerships in as many years. We've had 10 coalition and Labor leaders at the federal level in the last decade. I mean, that is extraordinary. If you put this in some sort of international context, you look at Canada.
Yeah.
Stephen Harper's been the leader of the Conservatives over there for more than a decade. David Cameron's been leader of the Tories for a decade. And John Key in New Zealand has been the leader of the National Party for a decade. Here in Australia, we just have this phenomenon called musical chairs. And it's really demoralising in many respects for both sides of politics.
Can you fix it? Can you go back to stability? Are there certain kinds of politicians that can engender that stability, do you think, Andrew?
I think it's really going to come down to what the parties do as far as, like, similar to what the Labor Party have been attempting to do with bringing in a rank and file vote, so that you can't have kind of a situation where you've got one prime minister sort of at 4 o'clock in the afternoon and a new one at 10 o'clock the following morning. And I think that probably it's going to be those kind of rules just to prevent these sort of coups that are going to stop it. Because, I mean, also, things come into fashion as well. Like, there was a real taste for double dissolutions for about 10 years, sort of just as a way of getting an early election. And I think to some degree, changing the leader has become sort of almost a soft reset on how you can get away with having an election. You can still get that change of narrative and that change the story out in the public without actually having to go through all the trouble of, you know, getting a vote.
All right, well, we'll see how it will unfold. Very big thank you to Tom Switzer and Andrew Beastreet. Thanks for joining us on the show.
Great to be here. Thanks so much.
All right, now some rather unpleasant things have been said about Abbott in the past few minutes, days. Okay, also years. But here at The Feed, we don't like to kick people when they're down, so we decided we would take a look back at Tony Abbott, the man, the myth, the Prime Minister.
So young, so beautiful. Anthony John Abbott, taken from us all too soon.
Yes, after 1 year, 361 days, Tony Abbott has beaten out Harold Holt for time in power because Harold Holt drowned, we think. Now, here at The Feed, we're often called a lefty lynch mob, a why the f*** are my taxes paying for this, and a less relevant BuzzFeed.
But today, we take a break from our kale smoothies and casual abortions to remember the fallen.
The Honourable Tony Abbott came screaming into this world through the wide, bloodied legs of Labor's incompetence. That date was September 18, 2013.
You obviously enjoyed hearing it, so let me say it again. The government of Australia has changed.
On the first day, he repealed the carbon tax. On the second day, he named himself Minister for Women. And on the third day, he looked at what he had created and saw that it was good. Amen. Or should I say, a women.
Where are the ladies, by the way? There are some ladies in this delegation.
There are, yes.
Where are they?
But by far, Abbott's greatest achievement was to do what he promised, cut a rug. As well as...
Stop the boats.
Stop the boats.
Stop the boats.
Stop the boats.
And you better believe he did just that.
The boats have stopped.
We're talking about the economy.
Taxes. The boats have stopped.
And where are those boats now? I don't know. Because thanks to Tony, the briefing stopped too, along with our crippling sense of international responsibility.
The last time you're going to see a bad guy like this again, let me tell you.
He was a tough man who wouldn't stand down from a fight, especially when faced with the toughest of opponents.
Look, I'm going to shirt front, Mr. Putin.
And he performed the shirt front with such stealth that to the untrained eye it appeared as nothing more than a polite handshake. But did Tone get any credit for this?
No. Instead, our public broadcaster, not us, was hell-bent on making him look bad.
It had become a haven for extremists.
See if you can guess who they are.
In order to rein in the out-of-control ABC, Tone did what any reasonable captain of Team Australia would do, banned frontbenchers from appearing on Q&A until the program was classified news and current affairs rather than entertainment.
Good move. That is not entertaining.
And finally, who could forget the onion-eating incident of March 12, 2015?
Very good.
And again on March 19, all in an effort to promote the failing Onions Australia market.
Tony leaves behind his loving wife, Margie, and his three not-bad-looking daughters, Bridget, Frances, and the other one. So let us all raise our onions and take a bite for the man who would do anything for his country. His adopted country. He was born in England.